Hey there once again, YouTube. My name is Ben Ferriogo, and I'm dedicated to the responsible and accurate seismic monitoring of volcanic and tectonic hazard areas. First off, if you have not already, please bookmark my website. A link is provided under my email address in the description box below. It contains a great deal of information, including how to understand the many types of plots and charts that people use, how to find, access, and analyze seismic data, and it also contains hundreds upon hundreds of seismic plots and images regarding a great many seismic events and swarms on many different pages. Trust me, you'd be surprised as to what you find. Yellowstone still has a lot of snow there. Wow, guys. So I woke up this morning and I noticed a large earthquake occurred. You can see it on many of these seismic stations at Yellowstone, especially here at MCID, which is my favorite station to use at Yellowstone for teleseisms. And so I checked it out. Let's zoom out real quick. Here we are at earthquakes.usgs.gov. Let's zoom out if my computer will let me. It is so slow today. All right, go down, go down, go down. All right, here it is right here. Notice there's a magnitude 7.0 at 257.4 kilometers in depth in Peru. And actually radiated away from the source pretty well and showed up on many seismic stations very, very, very far away. But first, before I get into that, I would like to mention another earthquake in Washington. There has been a little bit of an increase in seismicity as of late in Washington. Not too crazy, though. And remember, I live right about here, right in Botha, Washington. Glacier Peak Volcano. Notice it says Glacier Peak right there. This is the closest volcano to me, about 60 miles northeast of me or so, something like that. There's an earthquake that struck very close to it. I don't know if it's connected to Glacier Peak at all, but I'm just saying it's been a little while since I've seen an earthquake occur in close proximity to Glacier Peak. Notice it was a magnitude 1.2 at 5.2 kilometers in depth on March 1st, 2019, at 1348 UTC, 50 kilometers south-southwest of Mazama, Washington. Here we are at the USGS event page for the magnitude 1.2 that struck somewhat near Glacier Peak volcano. Stratovolcano, excuse me, in Washington State. Pacific Northwest Seismic Network put this out. Again, it was at about 5.2 kilometers in depth. Let's go to origin. Looks like they got the magnitude very correct. The depth uncertainty is plus minus 1.1, so it wasn't as correct. And the location uncertainty is pretty good. So let's go to phases, see what the closest seismic station was. So it's GPW, which I believe is the seismic station for Glacier Peak. So it could be connected to Glacier Peak because they do have earthquakes every now and then. So again, GPW, which is the seismic station for Glacier Peak, I believe. So why don't we go download the data for that right now and see what type of earthquake this was that struck right near Glacier Peak Stratovolcano. Let's do that. And then what was it? Okay, so it was UW GPW dash dash EHZ. Got the time period and date. Let's download the data, see if it works. Yep, it worked. Let's check it out in the seismic program swarm. So here we are in the seismic program swarm with the data stream from GPW, which is the seismic station for Glacier Peak Stratovolcano in Washington State, which is the volcano that is closest to where I live. Don't know what this is. Definitely does not look like any type of tremor event I have ever seen. Definitely not a tremor event because look how abruptly it stops right there. Notice that. That definitely looks like some type of electronic interference or something or some type of malfunction. Look how it just cuts off right there. Very strange. So I don't know what that was caused by. And again, here is the teleseism. You can see it on GPW. This is the teleseism for the magnitude 7.0 in Peru. And so let's go forward a little bit. Let's see, what time did the Glacier Peak earthquake hit? 1348. So about 1348. Remember, seismic waves take a few seconds to travel, depending on how far away the station was. Let's see, this is obviously a calibration wave. Whenever you see these, obviously you know they're not earthquakes, but these are calibration waves. Either they are automatic or manually done. And look at the background noise, 6 amplitude count. It is so quiet. Wow, that is probably the most quiet I've ever seen on any seismic station anywhere. Very impressive how quiet that is. Looks like there was a small earthquake actually right here at 243.50. Actually, I don't know what that was, but let's go to the earthquake 1348. What was it again? 1348.08. Takes a few seconds to travel, so it's this right here. Look at the strange, peculiar, very peculiar. They note that this was a magnitude 1.2 at 5.2 kilometers in depth, just to the northeast of Glacier Peak. Look at this. Very strange. Let's check out the dominant frequency, shall we? Notice very strange spectra plot. Notice that. We've got a peak at about 7.5 hertz. We have another peak at about 12.8 hertz. Then we have a third peak at about 16.7. And then we have a fourth peak at about 22.8. Was not a low frequency earthquake. Actually did contain some very strange high frequencies. And then again, there's that downwards dipping P wave, which I have seen a big increase in those. And I emailed IRIS and they said usually the upgoing P wave has to do with compression. But a downwards going P wave, I guess they say has to do with dilation, like maybe like something's opening. I don't know. I had a hard time understanding their explanation on that. I'm still learning about it. But again, here's the magnitude 1.2 at 5.2 kilometers in depth at Glacier Peak volcano, very close to it. Do not know what this was caused by. I cannot even venture a guess as to what process caused this earthquake. Let's see if there's anything else interesting throughout the day. A few tiny microquakes actually going on at Glacier Peak right now. Very, very tiny microquakes. Let's go forward. Not seeing much. Little teeny tiny microquakes going on. Again, there's the telseism. Let's go down here. Looks like there was a earthquake right here. Notice that? Oh, let's turn log power log frequency back on for the spectrogram plot. Look at this. There was another earthquake. Very interesting. Pretty long and drawn out too, so I don't know what's going on with Glacier Peak. Could it be getting more active? Possibly. To me, look at this. This right here definitely looks like a rock fall, a very small rock fall. Dominant high range frequencies and it's emergent. I'm not saying it is, but it very possible that it could be some type of rock fall. This, however, I don't think that's a rock fall. So let's scroll down and see if there's anything else interesting. Then we see some weird event appear right here, which has dominant frequency ranges of everything. All frequencies, basically. So that definitely does not look like any type of single event. Very strange. Oh, what's this right here? Let's go to the waveforms. A little tiny low frequency earthquake. Very interesting. So, what do you think is going on with Glacier Peak? Was this magnitude 1.2 related to any processes that Glacier Peak produces, or was it just a run-of-the-mill random tectonic earthquake? And again, here it is right here. excuse me, amplitude's going up to about 400. And right there, dominant high frequencies already showed the spectra. Now let's move on to the magnitude 7.0 in Peru. Strong and deep magnitude 7.0 strikes Peru. In this post, I will show some basic information and some seismic plots to the recent magnitude 7.0 that struck in Peru on March 1st, 2019, around 257 kilometers in depth. I will first show two deep focus earthquakes that have recently occurred, and then I will show the magnitude 7.0, blah, 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 blah. Now, since the beginning of 2019, many deep focus earthquakes have struck the world. Deep focus earthquakes are those which occur at 300 kilometers or deeper. The magnitude 7.0 that just struck Peru was almost a deep focus event. It struck, however, at a depth of 257.4 kilometers in depth, therefore dubbing it an intermediate depth earthquake. As explained in the USGS information shown later in this post, large magnitude intermediate depth earthquakes produce less damage above their foci than their more shallow events. However, due to the depth of the event, intermediate depth quakes can travel much farther. That means people a great distance away can feel the event. Right here, you can see a USGS earthquake map. It shows that there were 146 deep focus earthquakes of all magnitudes since January 1st, 2019. Notice how there were none up here. Most of them occurred under the southern hemisphere, except for up near Japan and the southern tip of Russia, right here. Of course, the recent magnitude 7.0 is not listed on this map since it was a little more shallow than the parameters that I entered. If you wish to visit the page that shows this map, then please click this button right here. Ever since January 1st, 2019, there have been many deep earthquakes that have struck deeper than 300 kilometers in depth. However, as of recently, the past week or so, as of March 1st, 2019, the deep earthquake activity has somewhat calmed. The link below is the earthquake catalog I used to see earthquakes deeper than 300 kilometers since January 1st, 2019. And I did not mean the link below, I meant the link above, because the link is above the text. There have been 146 events of all sizes. But again, the past few weeks, deep earthquake activity has quieted somewhat, except for a very deep magnitude 5.5 that struck just yesterday, as of the date I'm writing this. I will below show the largest deep focus earthquake since January 1st, and then I will show the most recent one. After that, I will show the data to the magnitude 7.0. Deep earthquakes are of particular interest to me, especially ones striking near 550 to 600 kilometers in depth, especially those going deeper than that. Although it has never been proven or recorded, I believe it is possible for earthquakes to occur all the way down to the outer core mantle boundary. Now first, again, I will show the largest deep focus event to occur from January 1st, 2019 to the time that I am writing this. It was a magnitude 6.8 earthquake in Brazil that struck at a very deep depth of 570.4 kilometers. Remember to always pay attention to all chart labels and any captions beneath any image. Also, although amplitudes on the magnitude 6.8 in Brazil were cut greatly by myself on the plots below, just know that the highest spike, which occurred at the P wave, registered around 5E5, which would be 500,000 amplitude count, on CZSB, which was the closest seismic station. It definitely was a strange deep earthquake event. The following is the magnitude 6.8 in Brazil that struck on January 5th, 2019 at 570.4 kilometers in depth. This is the location of the magnitude 6.8 in Brazil and the closest seismic station. CZSB will be used for the plots below as well as MCID from Yellowstone. Now let's scroll down. Here we have the USGS event page. Only 13 people reported feeling it. I was expecting a lot more people to feel it, but again, it was pretty deep. Pager looks good, and ground failure looks good as well. Let's scroll down. We have some helicorders. Here's the closest seismic station to the magnitude 6.8 in Brazil on January 5th, 2019. You can see it right here. Likely there were many other foreshocks prior to the event, and probably some aftershocks afterwards as well. Here's MCID for the same date. Here is the telesism right here of the magnitude 6.8 in Brazil, which struck at 570.4 kilometers in depth. Now here are the custom three plot images, which I generated for this magnitude 6.8. Again, I have cut the amplitudes greatly on this spike right here, just know it went up to 5E5. I did that to draw out these smaller amplitudes. Notice dominant low frequencies, even though this seismic station was the closest seismic station to this event. Very strange, but that could have to do with how deep it was. It was very deep. So probably more of the higher frequencies dissipated before arriving at the station. Look at the dominant frequencies though. It starts at about, what, 0.08 hertz or something like that, and actually dies down around 1 hertz. Of course, it has weaker frequencies going up to about 25, but the strongest frequencies remain below 1 hertz, which I thought was quite strange for an earthquake this deep, but then again, it could have to do with the depth. And here's simply another three-plot image I made, which is of the magnitude 6.8, but zoomed in so I could spread out the waveforms a little bit more to give you guys a better look. Again, dominant frequencies below 1 hertz, but there was a spike that ended at about 3 hertz. Let's go down. Here's the telesism of the magnitude 6.8 on January 5th, 2019 from seismic station MCID at Yellowstone. A typical telesism. There it is. Let's go down to the magnitude 5.5 in Argentina. The image shown here shows the location of the magnitude 5.5 in relation to the closest seismic station, AC02 in the C1 network. AC02 is the station I will use for the custom plots shown below. The second image above is the current USGS event page, and it's this image right here. The magnitude 5.5 struck on March 1st, 2019 at 0:13 UTC, about 8.5 hours before the magnitude 7.0 in Peru. And this magnitude 5.5 struck almost at 560 kilometers in depth. It is likely nobody felt this event due to its small size and deep depth. Now, nonetheless, it still was detected on seismic station MCID at Yellowstone. I like to use station MCID for teleseisms. Now, for the plots below, please remember to always read chart labels and any captions beneath any images. Also, the amplitudes on the seismogram plot for AC02, the closest station to the magnitude 5.5 in Argentina, was slightly cut to detect the smaller amplitudes. Notice we have AC02, the helicorder. In the network C1, you can see the magnitude 5.5 struck right here. Again, this magnitude 5.5 in Argentina struck around 560 kilometers in depth, just about 8.5 hours or so prior to the magnitude 7.0. And right here, we have the three-plot image that I generated myself from the closest seismic station. dominant lower frequencies. Obviously, probably because it was pretty deep, except the dominant lower frequencies are a little bit higher than the magnitude 6.8 in Brazil, which struck just a tiny bit deeper. So why did the magnitude 6.8 in Brazil in January have much lower frequencies than this one right here, than this magnitude 5.5? Thought that was very interesting. Let's go down, and again, here's the magnitude 5.5 in Argentina, except this data was taken from station MCID. Maximum frequency range on the spectrogram is 10 hertz. This goes up to about 2000 amplitude count, which is pretty strong for magnitude 5.5 at that depth. So MCID at Yellowstone did detect this event quite well. Again, dominant low frequencies indicative of a telesiasm. Now let's scroll down to the magnitude 7.0 in Peru that just recently struck last night. On March 1st, 2019 at 8:50 UTC, a strong 7.0 earthquake struck Peru at a depth of about 257.4 kilometers. This earthquake was actually reportedly felt by 240 people, and the count is probably still rising. The first image here is the location of the magnitude 7.0 in relation to the closest seismic station, which is LPAZ in the GT network. LPAZ will be the station I will use for the custom plots shown below. And this image right here is of the USGS event page for the magnitude 7.0 in Peru, again, which struck at 257.4 kilometers in depth. Again, 240 people reported feeling it. So far, that number could rise. They did have a tsunami warning real quick, but I do not think it will cause a tsunami. And here is the moment tensor for that as well. Let's scroll down just real quick. Now, here's the explanation that the USGS gave for the magnitude 7.0 in Peru. The March 1st, 2019 7.0 Peru earthquake near Lake Titicaca occurred as the result of normal faulting at an intermediate depth, approximately 260 kilometers beneath southeastern Peru, within the lithosphere, excuse me, of the subducted Nazca Plate. Focal mechanism solutions indicate that the rupture occurred on either a steeply dipping normal fault striking westward or on a shallowly dipping normal fault striking to the southeast. Slip on a fault of either orientation would accommodate the down dip extension of the Nazca slab. At the location of the earthquake, the oceanic Nazca plate moves east-northeast relative to the South American plate at a rate of about 71 millimeters per year, subducting at the Peru-Chile trench west of the Peruvian coast and sinking into the mantle beneath South America. Like most Western South America earthquakes, this event was caused by strains generated by the ongoing subduction process. Earthquakes like this event, with focal depths between 70 and 300 kilometers, are commonly termed intermediate depth earthquakes. Intermediate depth earthquakes represent deformation within subducted slabs rather than at the shallow plate interface between subducting and overriding tectonic plates. They typically cause less damage on the ground surface above their foci than is the case with similar magnitude shallow focus earthquakes, but large intermediate depth earthquakes may be felt at a great distance from their epicenters. Deep focus earthquakes, those with focal depths greater than 300 kilometers, also occur in the subducted Nazca Plate, farther east from the Peru-Chile Trench, beneath western Brazil and central Argentina. Earthquakes have been reliably located to depths of about 650 kilometers in this region. The Peru-Chile Trench is an area that hosts large earthquakes quite regularly. Yeah, they get slammed down there sometimes, guys. Within 500 kilometers of the February 22nd earthquake, there have been 10 other intermediate depth earthquakes with magnitudes of 6.5 and above over the preceding century. Today's earthquake is the largest of these. Again, this is the another info page that they showed that they said that the earthquake was the largest of these. That's been happening a lot lately. A lot of largest earthquakes occurring in very strange spots. Again, today's earthquake is the largest of these. Another magnitude 7.0 event occurred about 280 kilometers to the northwest in July 1991 at a depth of 100 kilometers. That event did cause some damage in Cusco. Now let's go down. We do have a helicorder of the magnitude 7.0, and there it is right there from the closest seismic station that I could get my hands on. Let's scroll down just real quick. Here's seismic station MCID, and there it is right there. Let's scroll down. Here is the custom three-plot image of the entire magnitude 7.0. I do not believe, yeah, I did not cut the amplitudes at all. So that's everything you're seeing, guys. I didn't even change the spectrogram at all. But yeah, it lasted a long time. Surface waves lasted, I'm gonna say, probably over an hour or two. Yeah, it was pretty good. It really rang the earth like a bell. And then you could see the dominant frequency start way low, maybe around 0.04 hertz, and then ends at about 1 hertz. Again, this was pretty deep, but not as deep as the magnitude 5.5 or the magnitude 6.8 just previously shown in this video and on this blog post. So I thought that was very intriguing that, again, we do have some dominant lower frequencies. Of course, weaker frequencies went beyond 20 hertz, but still, I was thinking we would see it maybe around 1 to 2 hertz, maybe higher than that, but starting at 0.04 hertz, wow, guys, that's pretty low. And here it is, zoomed in. I have cut the amplitudes over here to draw out the smaller amplitudes, and I have zoomed in. Again, dominant lower frequencies that we just talked about, but there are weaker frequencies going above, obviously. Again, this was a very strange earthquake, guys. Let's scroll down. Here's from Seismic Station MCID at Yellowstone. Going up to about 32,000 amplitude count, which is the maximum amplitude for the short period vertical state or short period stations, excuse me, at Yellowstone in the WY network. Very strong, guys. The majority of the earthquake, however, remained around 10,000 to 15,000 amplitude count. But still, that was pretty strong, guys. It was a very strong earthquake. Notice dominant. Excuse me, not dominant, but the top range of the frequency range is 15 hertz for the spectrogram. Remember, the importance of reading chart labels is paramount. Again, dominant low frequencies indicative of a telseism. So that's pretty much it for right now, guys. I am working on more stuff as we speak. Going to be putting out about 4 videos tonight. But that's only for a part of my website. It's not really meant for YouTube. I am still working on that GPS deformation video. Remember, I said I do not want to put that out there to you guys until I fully understand it myself. I have been having some problems understanding it. I'm not afraid to admit that I have problems, guys. I'm still learning. I'm still learning. And also we had that 7.0 and a nice, very interesting magnitude 1.2 right near Glacier Peak Volcano in Washington State. Seismicity usually remains pretty low around there. And as of 2 o'clock p.m. Pacific time, March 1st, 2019, here's the earthquakes. We did have one 3.1 in Oklahoma, wasn't too major, and we just had one in Japan actually. Let's check on Hawaii just real quick. I just want to take a quick look. And 9 earthquakes, nothing too major. Mainly remaining around Kilauea itself. So that's pretty much it. Let me know what you think. And do not forget to check out my website and Scott's new channel called the NW Geology Guy. Of course, links are always going to be in the description box below. Thank you guys, and I hope you have a wonderful day. God bless.